Good morning. Welcome to Salado United Methodist Church. If you are a visitor with us, we wanted to extend an even bigger welcome, if we can possibly do that, to you. And we are so glad to see you this morning. And lots of great things going on in the life of our church. I would like to draw your attention to the top left-hand corner of your bulletin handout. And on that is a QR code. If you wouldn't mind taking a couple moments as I go through the rest of the announcements and completing that for us to let us know that you're here. Paul is fine. He's okay. Happens to him all the time. That would be really, really great for us to see that you're here with us. some typical things that we have going on is our prime timers meet this Tuesday. And they get to meet in the Yak at 9 a.m. So that is continuing on. We do have our kickoff parties happening this week. I know for M&M Kids, and I know for the youth as well, Youth 412 is also having their kickoff party. So our children and our youth, be prepared, because this is going to be a fun event, and we're excited to see you this upcoming Wednesday. Choir will meet in the chapel at 7 p.m., and that is not a mistake. It is 7 p.m. And then we have a new study happening. It's called Crazy Love Sunday School. I'm sorry. That's the name of the Sunday School class. And the new study is The Will of God by Leslie Weatherford. And Weatherhead. On Sunday, August 28th. And everyone is welcome to join that if you are free. And then we are starting our Family Promise Support this week, August 28th. And this is at the new Family Promise site.
No.
Okay, so they have a new site.
That will be in 2 months.
It says August 28, 2022.
No, as far as the site.
Okay.
It's at the same place it's always been right now.
All right, so we appreciate your support. If you have any questions about that, I'd like to direct your attention to Mr. Raleigh back there. He can help you for more information. And then Handbell Choir is beginning next Wednesday, August 31st at 6 p.m. So be ready for that. That's going to be a lot of fun. And I love to see them when they are in our service. So we're excited to see them start up again. Like I said here in the beginning, welcome. And we're going to start with worship this morning with our introit. I know that song. That's titled Hosanna, and it's a really, really great contemporary style of that. Can we stand as we worship together? We're going to sing Praise to the Lord, the Almighty. Sing this together. Would you please remain standing and join with me as we say our affirmation, which comes from Romans 8. I will speak first, and then you will join in with me after. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No. In all things we are more than conquerors through the one who loved us. We are sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Glory be to the Father.
Seated.
As always, during our time of prayer, we want to remember those that you will find in the center of your bulletin, church family members, friends of our congregation, and those in the military who are in need of our prayer at this time. So we want to always remember them. If you would, please pray with me this morning. Holy and awesome God, you knew us before we took our first breath. You uttered your living word and brought forth light and love and life. And you have gathered us together and called us your people. You have sent us into the world to proclaim your mighty and wondrous deeds, and you are with us even now as we continue to serve that call. Merciful God, we know that your love never ends, but we must confess to you that we do not always share your love as we should. Where you have called us to live as one body, we sometimes exist as divided. When you have called us to use our Spirit-given gifts, we ignore your call. And when you have called us to forgive, we have forgotten your mercy toward us. Gracious God, do not be far from us this morning. Give us strength that we can be givers of your grace, and may your steadfast love be known to all of your children. Send your Holy Spirit to us this morning to empower our hands, to clothe people in need, to feed the hungry, and to love all as you have first loved us. So God, hear our prayers this morning as we lift up those who are in need. Give us hearts of courage and songs of your grace to tell others of your righteous acts and deeds of salvation. God, be with those of us this morning who are in need of restoration and healing. And we ask your blessing upon all those that we lift up in our hearts this morning. Faithful God, your power and your righteousness reach the heavens. Hear us, your servants, this morning as we follow you to the day when faith, hope, and love will be upon the lips of all of us, your children. We pray for these things in the name of your Son, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now it is time for our children's sermon. So children, if you will come up front with Miss Beth.
Yes.
All right.
Wow. Good morning, everybody. I want to ask you to do something, and everybody could do this, except maybe you. But would you all stand up? Okay? And I want you to, except for the girl with the baby in her arms, I wouldn't want her to hurt the baby. I want you to put, oh good, hi. Stand up and put your hands up in the air, both hands. And now I want you to bend all the way and try to touch your toes, but just kind of hang there. Now go up to about your knees and put your hand on your knees. And now I want you to pretend something with your hands on your knees, okay? Pretend that you're stuck there, okay? What would it be like if you were stuck like this for a very, very long time? Would you be able to recognize people by their face? It'd be hard. You'd be having to crook your neck up like that. What about playing basketball? Would that be hard to do if you were bent over all the time? In a minute, yeah. Can you touch your knees? Bend over and touch your knees. Okay, Miles. All right. Now, what would happen if you wanted candy on the top shelf? Liam, could you reach it if you were bent over?
No.
No? I don't think you could either. Okay. Now you can relax and sit down. Did that feel good to get out of the bent position? Okay. Well, in today's scripture story, there's a lady who was bent over just like that for 18 years. Yeah, that's a long time. She must have had a terrible time doing things. Do you think that some of the people might have stared at her or made fun of her? Yeah, I think so. That's 18 years. That's a long time. That's like from the time you're born until you graduate high school. Long time. Well, one day Jesus saw the woman, and what do you think that Jesus wanted to do for her? He wanted to straighten her up so she could have a normal life, didn't he? She was probably sick. She probably hurt. He wanted her out of the pain. Well, he didn't wait. He went right to her, and he touched her, and he said, "Woman, be healed." And she stood up, and she was normal again, and she could move again, and she wasn't in any more pain. Wow, can you imagine how that must have felt after 18 years of finally getting to see the world again? You would think that everyone would have been really, really happy. Well, guess what? There was one that wasn't. And he was the leader of a synagogue. It's kind of like a church. he was angry. It was the Sabbath, and that was the day that people are they set aside to worship God. And that's a commandment that people should not worship, should not work on the worship day. Well, instead, they should go to church and pray and think about God. The angry man said that Jesus should have waited another day because healing the lady was a kind of work instead of worship. He thought that the poor woman should suffer one more day so that nobody broke a rule. If that poor woman were your grandmother, or if she were somebody you loved, would you want Jesus to wait? No, no. Jesus told the synagogue leader something like this. He said, "Man, you were only pretending to care about God's law. If you were really a person who cared about keeping God's law, you would not want the woman to be bent over one more second." Jesus knew that there was a more important commandment, and that one is love your neighbor. That's the law that the man should have thought about, isn't it? The woman's health was more important than the law about when and when not to go to work. Okay, Jesus did the right thing. He loved his neighbor, so he helped her. Let's pray. Ready? Dear God, thank you for Jesus, who shows us how you love us more than anything else. Help us love our neighbor in the exact same way. Thank you, God. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, Miles, guess what? You can have some candy now.
As our children get their candy and make their way back to their seat, I'd like to invite you to stand as we continue to worship and pray, singing one of my favorites, "Here I Am, Lord."
I am named the star.
You may be seated.
The time has come in our worship service now to return gifts to God. And believe it or not, giving gifts to God is part of worship. The Israelites and people even before they became officially the Israelites sacrificed animals and burned them in fires because that was the way that they worshiped. The way that we worship is we give a portion of what we have earned by the, as they say, the sweat of our brow. And so I would like to invite the ushers to come forward after I say the prayer blessing over the offering. Gracious God, it is very easy for us to forget. To forget what our forebears have done for us in providing this church and its land, in providing the building that we worship in, providing the guidance and moral navigation that we need to get through life, who have taught our children and for us for many years, and so we give you thanks. We ask that as we take up this offering, that these pieces of offering might be used in the same way that they have in this church for 170 years. And we pray this and all things in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Thank you. I have a few things to say. When our previous bishop moved me to this church to reward me for my good work, I was not surprised to find that this church was 20% the size of the one where I'd been for 13 years. And I thought I did okay. The church thought I did okay. Everybody thought I did okay. But I thought to myself, you know, I am a United Methodist pastor. And when the bishop deploys me someplace, that's where I go. I'm an itinerant pastor. I've been itinerant since I was ordained in June of 1977. Does that seem like a long time ago? It does to most of the churches that I've pastored, I can tell you that. And so one of the reasons that I was kind of interested and excited to come to this church, I'd been pastoring Georgetown for 7 years, and there's some people in the congregation that have retired from Georgetown to Salado, so they were my previous church members. Some of them I've known since 1989, which also seems like a long time ago. I was excited to come here because Salado always has had the reputation of being a rock-solid United Methodist Church. Now, over the years, there have been some people that got upset that it wasn't a Baptist church. And so they left. And if I had been here, I would have happily held the door open for them. I'm going to tell you a secret. We have enough Baptist churches in Salado already. We do not need to become that. And so one of the things that I want to say is, and one of the, I think, fundamental principles of being a United Methodist is that we follow John Wesley. And one of John Wesley's central dictums was this: we think and let think. It's not that you disagree with me, so you need to get the heck out of here. We've never been that way. I've seen Sunday school classes. In Georgetown especially, they had a Sunday school class there called the Contemporary Forum. I called it the All-Star Wrestling class. Because when people would come to Sunday school, they would just go toe to toe with each other, and they would fuss and fight and make threats and all that kind of stuff. At the end of the class, they'd have a little prayer, then they'd all hug each other and go out to eat lunch, to wait 7 days to come back and repeat the process once again. I couldn't believe it. If some of the people said what they did to each other to me, I wouldn't hug them. Well, I don't like to hug people anyway, so that'd just be a good excuse. But this is the point, that if you have to go to a church where everybody agrees with everything that you think, then you are in a little silo, and you never grow as a person. You never have any new ideas. You don't grow intellectually, emotionally, any other way. So I have been asked to state between the Global Methodist Church, which was my previous bishop's, it's mostly his undertaking and the people that he has recruited for 12 years while he was our bishop, to start a new denomination. I say, blessed be those who want to do that. That's fine. But you don't need to take a whole group of people that really are happy with their church and have been for years and years and years. And so somebody said, we need to know whether you're on the side of the UMC or the GBC. I have many, many close friends in the Global Methodist Church. Up at Temple, Tom Robbins, he's been a friend of mine for 30 years. His dad was my mentor in the ministry. His brother, who's in Little Rock, Arkansas, was my first youth minister. I was with the family when the boy's mother died. I mean, I am tied to them as completely as somebody can be tied to a family that's not blood kin. So I'm saying that I am a United Methodist pastor. I have been since 1977. I've gone where the bishop told me to go. My very first appointment, I was called and they said, you're going to Corsicana. Well, I didn't know where Corsicana was, so I said, where is it? He said, doesn't matter, they'll find you. The point is simply this, that I am loyal to the United Methodist Church. I understand why there are people who aren't. I understand the reasons, and I bless them in their thinking, but that doesn't necessarily mean that I think that way. So, I am a loyal United Methodist, and I will be, no matter, you know, what happens in the next coming months, not only to us, but to the whole denomination. You just never know what's going to happen. I pray that God will somehow insert some common sense, some common decency, and some grace in the negotiations that we are having, and really leave it in God's hands. Let us pray. Gracious God, we are your people. We are the sheep of your pasture. You have provided for us for millennia, and we ask that as we go forward into the future this afternoon, this week, this month, and for the rest of the year, that your Spirit would guide us and hold us close to you. And we pray this in Jesus' holy name. Now, there have been a few people that have been trying to organize some small groups over the next couple, 3 weeks. To discuss these matters. There are people that want a big group so everybody can yell at each other or whatever happens there, but we decided a small group would be better for some genuine conversation, and so there will be 5, 7, 9 small groups, and if you look in your newsletter or in the email blast, you can see the schedule and you can sign up for one of those. How many of y'all, when you think of Jesus, think of him as a rule breaker? Okay. Bunch of liberals, I see. Well, Jesus broke some rules, and a Pharisee called him on it, a leader of the synagogue, who was indignant that Jesus broke this rule. So our text today comes from Luke 13, 10 through 17, if you want to take a look at that. Now he was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath, and just then there appeared a woman with a spirit that had crippled her for 18 years. She was bent over and was quite unable to stand up straight. I've heard about this someplace this morning. When Jesus saw her, he called her over and he said, "Woman, you are set free from your ailment." When he laid his hands on her, immediately she stood up straight and began praising God. But the leader of the synagogue, indignant because Jesus had cured on the Sabbath, kept saying to the crowd, "There are 6 days on which work ought to be done. Come on those days and be cured, not on the Sabbath day." But the Lord Jesus answered him and said, "You hypocrites, does not each of you on the Sabbath untie his ox or his donkey from the manger and lead it away to give it water? And ought this woman, a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan bound for 18 long years, be set free from this bondage on the Sabbath day?" When he said this, all of his opponents were put to shame, and the entire crowd was rejoicing at all the wonderful things that he was doing. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Now, this healing that Jesus does here shows that he is a citizen in God's realm, or in the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God. And he not only heals this woman, but he identifies her as a daughter of Abraham, which is high praise for somebody. And it also suggests that she was a member of Jewish society. She was a Jewish person. And one of the things that, if you read the Gospels carefully, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you will notice that Jesus constantly is accepting all people and welcoming them into the kingdom of God. Women, the infirmed who were not to worship in the synagogues or in the temple because of their infirmity that made them disqualified for worshiping there. All kinds of people, Jesus welcomed these. And what's interesting about this story to me, there's a lot of interesting aspects to it. Well, really to every Bible story. But here especially, it's interesting to me that she does not ask Jesus to heal her. Did you notice that? No one else in the crowd said, "Hey, Jesus, look at this woman. She's infirm. She has an affliction. Go heal her." Nobody said that. Jesus just sensed that she wanted to be healed. And he didn't really even ask her. He just healed her. Don't you hate that when somebody just comes up to you and heals you? You didn't even ask about it. Well, it happened to this particular woman. And she reacts in praise. She thanked God for what had happened to her. But wouldn't you know it, there's always somebody in the crowd that doesn't like what's going on. He was a ruler of the synagogue, we're told in this particular story, and he is indignant, which was a really biblical way of saying he was really hacked off. He was very upset. He didn't like this one little bit, and so he starts popping off. I don't know how he did it. The text says he spoke to the crowd, but maybe he went home, got on Facebook, and was telling everybody that way. That's a way we communicate our disdain for something. And he's speaking to many, and he aims his words. He acts like he's speaking to everybody, but he's really speaking to Jesus. And he has obviously missed the point of this healing. The synagogue leader, if he was here today, would remind us, like he was reminding people in ancient Israel, that we have forgotten the Sabbath. I had an Old Testament professor, and he was Canadian, so we weren't really sure about him as a foreigner with a funny accent, who said A after every sentence. He told us that his mother would not let him play baseball on Sundays when he was a kid because it was the Sabbath. Now, I don't know what we can't do today because it's the Sabbath, but I would like to say pretty little can we not do. Can you imagine your house is on fire and the fire people come and they say, I'm sorry, can't put your fire out. I have to wait until sundown when the Sabbath is over. No, we're pragmatic, practical people. We do what seems to be the best thing to do. But if you recall in the Ten Commandments, 1/10 of the commandments have to do with the Sabbath. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy, Exodus 28. Deuteronomy 5:12 says essentially the same thing, but a little bit differently. Observe the Sabbath day and keep it holy as the Lord your God commanded you. The Ten Commandments are pretty inflexible when it comes to Sabbath keeping. Exodus 20, 10 through 11 says, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. You shall not do any work. You, your son, your daughter, your male or female slave, your livestock, your resident alien in your towns, for 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth and sea and all that is in them, but rested on the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath and consecrated it. There's no question. None. The Sabbath is very important to Israel and therefore to Jesus. And I think you could say is if the Sabbath was good enough for Yahweh or for God the Creator, it ought to be good enough for us. It's the Sabbath is key, so key that the rebuttal that Jesus gives is even more clever perhaps than we realize. He uses this idea that's from the Mishnah, which is a Jewish book of laws, that says that untying an ox or a donkey on the Sabbath is verboten. And then in another part, it says, you can do it. Why let your animal die of thirst when you should at least let it drink water? And so Jesus is saying, in effect, in this story that he's telling, is if it is permissible to untie a donkey on the Sabbath, why is it not permissible to untie a woman who has been bound by Satan in her affliction? That's what he says. And those in the synagogue, from the context of the story, realize that Jesus may be right about this, and he essentially shames those who were speaking against the healing of this woman. In the ancient Near East, and still today, we Americans like to think about right and wrong. Let me give you an example. I'm right, you're wrong. That's how it works. In the ancient Near East, and in the Near East today, people go by the code of honor or shame. Is this thing I am about to do going to bring honor to my family, or is it going to bring them shame? Prodigal son story goes to far country and spends all of his money. He is bringing shame to his family. So when he comes dragging up to the house, tail between his legs, he is absolutely ashamed. He makes a speech. He goes over it, over it, over it on his way back to the house. And his father puts his hand up and says, "You do not need to make that speech. You are my son. You are welcomed back in this home." And so not only is Jesus a wonder worker in this particular healing of this woman who has been bound by Satan for 18 years. 18 years is a long time. It's just about long enough time to get your kids through those teenage years, which is the source of many prayers in many houses in our world today. Now, you may wonder why he was, this leader of the synagogue was so adamant about keeping Sabbath, and there's a reason for that. Over the years, I don't know if this is going to sound familiar to any of y'all, over the years, people tended to either not observe the Sabbath anymore or observe it in a sort of a haphazard way. And so one of the main jobs the Pharisees saw themselves as providing for their society is to continually remind people about the importance of the Sabbath. And that's what they were doing here. And the reason that we know people neglected the Sabbath is because if you read Isaiah or you read Amos, you will see various prophecies in there that talk about that. Now, there are many more things that I would like to say about this, but you cannot bear them now. So I do want to remind us of four things. The purpose of the Sabbath are these four primary reasons. Number one, they provide rest for weary people. If you've worked all week, you need to take some time off so that you can be more effective in your work. You need to rest. There is no problem that you have that can't be helped by a good nap. That's my theory of life. Another thing is that we take this Sabbath time to embrace people that we care about and love. And I just had a conversation with somebody today that felt really bad about not spending the Sabbath with the children. And it just happened to come up that way. Some of you have heard of Leonardo da Vinci. In fact, today in 1911, the Mona Lisa was stolen from the art gallery that it was in. And this is what da Vinci said, who was probably one of the most brilliant people that's ever lived. "Every now and then go away. Have a little relaxation, for when you come back to your work, your judgment will be surer. since to remain constantly at work will cause you to lose power of judgment. So the third thing, after you embrace the people that are important to you, is to feast on the goodness of God and creation. Those are reasons for the Sabbath. That's all I'm going to say about this. All right. I want to open the doors of the church if there's someone that would like to unite with the Salado United Methodist Church. I invite you to come forward and meet me here at the communion rail, and we will take you in a good way. Our final hymn of invitation is "Just As I Am Without One Plea." May we stand, please. Go in the peace of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Have a great week.